Hello, I'm Colonel Bill Hodgkins, the current and the last commander of the 32nd Fighter Group. The video presentation that you're about to see depicts the rich heritage, the history, and the success of our 40-year stay in the Netherlands. It's a tribute to the men and women and their pride, dedication, and contribution to the defense of the Netherlands, of NATO, and of the United States of America. It depicts many elements of our successful mission execution. I'd remind you as you're watching the video, the unit, though, is made up much more of just its accomplishment of the mission. It's made up of the men and women, the people who serve in that unit. It is to those men and women, the current and the former 32nd Wolfhound, that this presentation is dedicated.
When the decision was made to put United States forces on Dutch soil, Dwight D. Eisenhower was president. The Marshall Plan was in full force. The Korean War had just ended. NATO was in its infancy, and the Dutch guilder rate was 4.28 to the dollar. The driving force behind the placement of U.S. Air Forces in Holland was a NATO defense study which made suggestions for improving and bolstering air defense in the Central European region of NATO. After discussions with the Dutch government, the decision was made to place the squadron of U.S. Air Force interceptors at the Royal Netherlands Air Force base of Soesterberg because of its central location within this NATO area of responsibility. The first aircraft assigned to Soesterberg were F-86F Sabres. These aircraft came as the 512 Fighter Day Squadron, which flew direct from RAF Manston, England. The first aircraft to arrive was flown by the commander of the squadron, Lieutenant Colonel Frank M. Haney, on November 16, 1954. The flight took all of 26 minutes and was met at the Dutch border by Royal Netherlands Air Force Gloster Meteor MK-7 of 328 Squadron. The small part of the base assigned to the Americans received the name Camp New Amsterdam as a reminder of the first Dutch colony in America, New Amsterdam, which was later renamed New York. The original contingent of Americans was only 270 officers and airmen. Although clear in its mission of augmentation to the Royal Netherlands Air Forces, the 512th's lack of historical connection to the Dutch caused the U.S. Air Force to search for an appropriate unit designation with the desired connection. After an extensive search, officials made a decision to assign the unit designation of an inactive World War II squadron, which had served, if not in the Netherlands proper, then at least on Dutch soil, Curaçao and Aruba. From these Dutch islands, the 32nd Fighter Squadron tried to track down groups of German submarines, which working together were inflicting heavy losses on Allied shipping in the Caribbean. These groups were known as Wolf Packs and resulted in the squadron nickname of Wolfhounds. The squadron emblem at the time was the vicious and visibly hungry wolf head designed by Walt Disney Studios. As a result of both the wolf emblem and the squadron mission of hounding German U-boats, the nickname of Wolfhounds came into being. As the 32nd Fighter Day Squadron, the Wolfhounds were reactivated on September 8, 1955 at Soesterberg Air Base. With that action began the long history of the 32nd in Holland. Not quite a year later, the 32nd became supersonic when it received the F-100C Super Sabre to replace the F-86F Sabre brought to Soesterberg from England. The transition to the Super Sabre was completed August 30th, 1956. In order to accommodate the new aircraft, the runway had to be extended to 10,200 feet. This was completed August 8th, 1956. During this time, the 32nd Fighter Day Squadron reported to the 36th Fighter Day Group, stationed at Bitburg Air Base, Germany. The 32nd experienced its first of 12 aircraft fatalities on May 28, 1957, when First Lieutenant Alan N. Ray went down with his F-100C as it approached Soesterberg Air Base. The F-100 was a tricky plane to fly, and as a result, a total of 8 F-100s were lost over 4 years, 3 by one pilot alone. 2 years later, the 32nd received the first of several outstanding unit awards, and on July 8, 1958, the squadron was redesignated the 32nd Tactical Fighter Squadron. It was 5 years later that one of the most distinguishing trademarks of the 32nd was created. The wreath and crown of the Netherlands royal family was added to the distinctive wolfhound patch. The integration of these symbols represented the squadron's close ties to the Royal Netherlands Air Force's Soesterberg wing. The crown at the top of the patch symbolizes royalty, and the wreath with oranges represents an orange tree, a traditional symbol of the Dutch royal family, the House of Orange, who were direct descendants of William of Orange, the first prince of the Netherlands. This revision gave the 32nd Squadron patch the same outline as all of the squadrons of the Royal Netherlands Air Force and symbolized the complete integration of the American unit into the host nation's Air Force. An application to adopt the crest was sent to President Eisenhower, and the squadron was referred to as the first Royal United States Squadron in the world by Lieutenant General A.B. Wolfe, Royal Netherlands Air Force Chief of Staff, during a later anniversary ceremony. On July 8, 1959, the squadron went through another name change. It was renamed the 32nd Fighter Interceptor Squadron. After 4 years of flying the F-100C Super Sabre, it was time once again to change the aircraft. This time, it was the F-102A, an all-weather interceptor. Just prior to the F-102's arrival, the squadron was reassigned to the 86th Fighter Interceptor Wing, which had its headquarters at Ramstein Air Base in Germany. Its primary mission was standing quick reaction alert interception, better known as Zulu Alert. Zulu Alert consisted of 24 hours a day, 5-minute response from the sound of the alert klaxon to being airborne. Once in the air, the Wolfhounds would be vectored by Royal Netherlands Air Force radar controllers to within firing range of any intruding aircraft. This proved to be particularly important during 1962 with the increase in tensions from the Cold War as a result of the Cuban Missile Crisis. The 32nd demonstrated its proficiency when, in 1965, it won first place in the F-102 category of the Worldwide Fighter Interceptor Weapons Meet, known as William Tell. At the 1965 William Tell meet, the 32nd became the first overseas unit to ferry its own aircraft to the continental United States to take part in the competition. The squadron took 30 technical staff members to the meet, including ground personnel from the Royal Netherlands Air Force. Scoring 8,782 out of a possible 11,000 points, the binational team of the 32nd Fighter Interceptor Squadron received the highest score in the F-102 category and took first place. As a result of this victory, the 32nd Fighter Squadron was awarded its first Hughes Trophy in 1966. This trophy recognizes the most outstanding air defense unit in the U.S. Air Force and is provided by Hughes Corporation, the maker of the F-102 and many subsequent fighter radar systems. The receipt of this award validated to the Air Force what the Wolfhounds already knew. They were the best. Upon their return to Soesterberg, the team was greeted and congratulated by His Royal Highness, Prince Bernhard. As an added compliment, the Swiss village of Altdorf, the village where William Tell fired his legendary shot, presented the squadron with the William Tell plaque. In 1966, the 32nd's outstanding heritage continued to show as they garnered the Silver Anvil, the highest honor bestowed by the public affairs profession from the Public Relations Society of America. Additionally, the squadron was awarded its second Air Force Outstanding Unit Award in this period. As with everything else in life, there comes bad with good. And so it was during the summer of 1966, when during an engine start, an F-102 caught fire. Although one aircraft and a major portion of the Zulu Alert facility were destroyed, loss of life was avoided by the quick thinking and valiant efforts of the maintenance personnel. 5 people were awarded the Airman Medal for their actions in saving the other aircraft and the pilots. It is noteworthy to mention that during their tenure here, only 2 F-102s were lost. During this period, the 32nd recorded victories in NATO's annual air defense competition in 1966, 1967, and once again in 1970. In 1968, and again in 1970, the 32nd Armament Loading Team recorded the fastest times and highest scores for the F-102 category in the USAFE Weapons Loader Competition, LODEO. During 1968, a major organizational change took place as the 32nd was assigned directly to 17th Air Force. In 1969, two significant changes occurred to the 32nd. First, the squadron was redesignated the 32nd Tactical Fighter Squadron, and they transitioned from the F-102 to the F-4E Phantom II, the latest version of the well-known versatile all-weather fighter. During this transition, Operation Palace Guard was implemented. While the 32nd pilots were training on the new McDonnell Douglas F-4E Phantom II, 18 U.S. Air National Guard pilots spent 6 months sitting alert in Wolfhound F-102s at the rebuilt Zulu Alert Facility. His Royal Highness Prince Bernhard presented the 32nd with a special fanion, a royal decoration, on 16 November 1974 to commemorate 20 years of contribution to the defense of Dutch airspace. That fanion has been used as the official squadron flag from that moment on. In 1974, Soesterberg won its third Lodeo. Since 1974, the squadron continued to achieve significant operational success as a prime air defense unit of the NATO force structure. 1975 saw the 32nd receive an Air Force Flying Safety Award for accident-free flying. Because the F-4 was a two-place aircraft and more sophisticated than its predecessors, it required many more Americans to be stationed at Soesterberg in order to fly it, maintain it, and support those that did. As a result, the American contingent had progressively grown from 270 personnel to a high in excess of 1,500 in the mid-70s. Because most of these Americans brought their families to their Soesterberg assignment and were replaced by others about every 3 years, it is estimated that around 500,000 Americans have passed through this community over the 40 years the unit was stationed in Holland. As the American population continued to grow at Camp New Amsterdam, the need for family housing was recognized, and 190 new 2, 3, and 4 bedroom Apollo housing units in the village of Soesterberg released and accepted for occupancy by May of 1978. In 1987, the name Camp New Amsterdam was returned to its original title and was once again known as Soesterberg Air Base, reflecting the many Dutch communities surrounding the base that the Wolfhounds called home. During this time, the squadron lost only one Phantom, Captain Mickey L. Johnston and Captain Patrick H. Pondren, losing their lives in a crash in the North Sea. These were the last of the 12 Wolfhound aviators to lose their lives while maintaining the air defense of NATO's central region. After 9 years of flying the F-4E Phantom, Soesterberg saw what could be considered as the most monumental event to date come to pass. Beginning on September 13, 1978, with the arrival of the first two Eagles and culminating with the arrival of the last contingent of aircraft, marked 1978 as the year the 32nd entered the era of the Eagle. Soesterberg was the first U.S. Air Force unit stationed outside the continental United States to be equipped with the world's premier air superiority fighter. The F-15 represented a quantum improvement in the unit's ability to exercise its NATO mission. It was able to scramble faster, accelerate better, climb higher, and its radar and missiles could reach out and touch someone much further than any jet fighter in existence for the next 20 years. Having already been recognized with one of Hughes' trophy, it came natural to the Wolfhounds that with the F-15, it was to win a second award in 1979 and again the very next year. Winning the award again in 1980 guaranteed the 32nd a place in Air Force history. The squadron became the first unit in history to have won the award 3 times, and more significantly, the first squadron in U.S. Air Force to have won the Hughes Trophy in consecutive years. The most well-known real-world intercept using the F-15 was the highlight of the 4th of July celebration of 1989. Two pilots were scrambled to intercept an unidentified aircraft over German airspace. The aircraft was identified as a Soviet MiG-23, from which the pilot had ejected. The aircraft flew further westward and crashed in Belgium near the French border when it ran out of fuel. In 1984, the 32nd Tactical Fighter Squadron was selected to represent USAFE at the William Tell Meade and Tyndall Air Force Base, Florida. After practicing gun and missile attacks at Zaragoza Air Base, Spain, and RAF Valley on the Isle of Anglesey, UK, on September 27, 1984, 8 F-15 Eagles were sent across the Atlantic Ocean to compete at Tyndall. Although unable to finish better than sixth in the team competition, Captain Scott Turner took first place in the individual competition and earned the title Top Gun. During this period, the 32nd surpassed the 70,000 flying hour mark without a major aircraft accident while flying the F-15 fighter. The 32nd was the first squadron outside the CONUS to reach this milestone. Because the unit's size had remained relatively constant from the mid-1970s and was much larger than a normal Air Force fighter squadron, the U.S. government requested that the Dutch government allow the unit to be upgraded to a fighter group. In 1989, the Dutch government agreed that the 32nd Fighter Squadron could assume group status. On November 16, 1989, 35 years to the day of the arrival of the first American interceptors in the Netherlands, the 32nd Tactical Fighter Group was activated. What used to be the operations detachment of the 32nd Tactical Fighter Squadron became the fighter squadron itself. This unit, including the pilots, life support and operation support personnel, was now identical to any other U.S. Air Force fighter squadron. Fortunately, the Wolfhounds were never called upon to exercise their wartime skills in NATO's central region. As a direct result of the resolve and solidarity of NATO as a whole and in part, due to the excellent cooperation and working relationship between the 32nd Fighter Squadron and its Dutch host base, the world saw the collapse of the Berlin Wall and the subsequent dissolution of the Warsaw Pact. However, in early 1990, Iraqi dictator Saddam Hussein occupied the small neighboring country of Kuwait, and quickly a similar coalition force was banded together under the umbrella of Operation Desert Shield. Just after hostilities started and Desert Shield was redesignated Operation Desert Storm, many 32nd Tactical Fighter Group pilots, F-15s, and maintenance crews deployed to Incirlik Air Base, Turkey, to support the Joint Task Force Operation Proven Force. During the 41-day war, many Wolfhounds were sent to support the operations conducted primarily in southern Iraq and Kuwait by opening a second front of the air war through air attacks against targets in northern Iraq. This American presence in northern Iraq eliminated the enemy air force's ability to withdraw its aircraft to the north, away from coalition forces, and prevented many Iraqi units from fleeing to neighboring Iran. This American presence in northern Iraq eliminated the enemy air force's ability to withdraw its aircraft to the north, away from coalition forces, and prevented many Iraqi units from fleeing to neighboring Iran. In fact, on January 28, 1991, a 32nd Tactical Fighter Squadron pilot, Captain Muddy Watros, successfully engaged and shot down an Iraqi MiG-23 aircraft attempting to flee into neutral Iran. The 32nd Tactical Fighter Squadron pilots flew 247 combat sorties and logged 1,074 hours. As a result of the 32nd's contribution to this highly successful coalition effort against a solitary tyrant and dictator, the 32nd Tactical Fighter Group was awarded another Air Force Outstanding Unit Award, the last of seven awarded to the unit. In 1991, another and final name change occurred as a result of the overall reorganization of the U.S. Air Force. This time, the 32nd Tactical Fighter Group became simply the 32nd Fighter Group, a name which more accurately depicted the flexibility that fighters had displayed during the Gulf War. At the same time, of course, the 32nd Tactical Fighter Squadron became more simply the 32nd Fighter Squadron. During this change, the squadron was reorganized to incorporate its entire 212-person aircraft maintenance unit. 1 year later, the 32nd was again in Turkey with 8 aircraft and over 130 personnel supporting Joint Task Force operations, Operation Provide Comfort, enforcing the United Nations mandated no-fly zone over Iraq. During this 5.5-month period, the The Wolfhounds flew 753 sorties in over 3,500 hours and successfully prevented the Iraqi Air Force from challenging the no-fly zone. This allowed the UN to deliver food, heating supplies, and various humanitarian goods to the oppressed Kurdish people in the north. The final chapter for Susterberg was set in motion when further drawdowns and force structure changes put the 32nd on the hit list.
Beginning on the 6th of July, we're going to have a headquarters youth safety project task force at Susterberg to begin working the details of base closure.
As with any significant milestone, many memorable events were planned. Colonel Bill Hodgkins led the initial departure of F-15s from Susterberg and oversaw the departure in a celebration recognizing this momentous event. The final F-15s departed Susterberg on January 13, 1994. Just as the F-86s had been escorted by Royal Netherlands Air Force fighters from the Dutch border to Susterberg, the F-15s departing Susterberg were joined by the Royal Netherlands Air Force F-16s from 316 Squadron and were escorted by them to the Dutch border.
Well, there you have it, 40 years of history, 40 years of Wolfhound history, rich in success, rich in tradition, and rich in the many memories that it's provided. It's with a lot of mixed emotions that we bring this history to a close, emotions that range from sadness in losing such a wonderful place to be assigned, a place that's held with such deep regard and affinity for so many former members. Sadness in parting ways with our Dutch friends and neighbors. But I think more importantly, the pride of our members here and former members in being a part of the success that has brought such a radical change in the complexion in Europe as we see it today compared with only a few short years ago. For this reason, we're able to leave this base in line with other bases that are closing in Europe as both the U.S. and other NATO countries now restructure their military forces. But for those who are concerned, rest assured that if we're needed, we'll be back.